Tonight's talk is entitled Nutrition and Brain Function, the Relationship Between Your Diet and Your Mind. We are very pleased to have Avery Haynes as our host tonight. Avery has 20 years of experience in radio and television, and as a reporter, anchor, and host, Avery has spent time at reporting and anchoring at CTV and is currently a reporter for City News with City TV. She has also worked on the Discovery series Health on the Line and Medical Hot Seat, earning her multiple nominations and 2 Geminis for Best Television Talk Series. She also received Radio Television News Directors Association Awards for Best Canada News Radio Newscaster and Best Spot Reporter. She has also been writing a book, publishing feature articles in Costa Rica, where she lived with her family for almost 2 years, often without electricity and water, and she is producing a radio documentary on the burgeoning gay rights movement in China. Joining Avery tonight is Dr. Carol Greenwood, Senior Scientist and Assistant Director of the Kuhn and Lunenfeld Applied Research Unit here at Baycrest. Dr. Greenwood is also a professor in the Department of Nutritional Sciences at University of Toronto. The focus of her research is the relationship between diet and brain function. Her 2 key areas of interest include healthy seniors and the impact of lifelong dietary patterns on risk and cognitive decline with aging, and the role of type 2 diabetes, which is non-insulin dependent, as a risk factor for cognitive decline and dementia. Carol and Avery will be joining us on the stage following this brief video that will begin tonight's talk. We hope you enjoy your evening. And the video, please.
As a chef, we always hear you are what you eat. And it's very, very true. You know, our bodies respond to what we feed them. So we need to feed them the best things that we have available. And through the typical channels of grocery stores, you don't always get what's fresh and what's local, and there's a lot of impact that has on our health and our diet.
My main interest is really trying to look at the relationship between diet and nutrition and brain health. So we're really interested in trying to understand what it is about our diet that may increase our risk in terms of cognitive loss as we age, or more optimistically, what can we do at a proactive level in terms of helping to retain our brain function with aging, using diet as one of the interventions. We were really the first to show that the average North American diet, if consumed in middle age, can contribute to cognitive decline. When we first started doing this work, people were arguing that the brain was insensitive to diet after development, so that we didn't have to worry about brain function after we were about 7 or 8 years of age and we had all of our, you know, brain tissue there, that after that the brain was protected. And so not only was our data showing, no, that's not true, our brain continues to be sensitive to our diet, but it was also saying that the types of eating patterns that were traditional in North America, particularly high fat, high meat, low in fruits and vegetables, were contributing to cognitive decline.
With our busy lifestyles, it's so easy to depend on processed and prepackaged foods. If you're going to do that, you need to search out the ones that are low in fat, high in nutritional value. There are options that aren't just the freezer section of your grocery store. You can go into local markets and get, again, ready-to-go meals that you know were cooked by chefs, going to be high in nutritional value, and be great to take home and feed to your family. So avoiding processed foods to me is really, really important, especially with young kids and with older people. Processed foods just destroy any chance of getting the most nutritional value out of the food that you're eating.
I think what's really interesting when you start to look at issues around nutrition and brain health is to recognize that those issues change dramatically as we move throughout the lifespan. So, for instance, when we're in our 50s and 60s, that's when we can be most proactive in terms of changing our lifestyle. So we're doing what we can in terms of setting our brains up for healthy aging. And then once we get into our 70s and beyond is really being focused on retaining that body weight rather than trying to move it upwards or downwards. What we know in terms of looking at some longitudinal studies of seniors and seniors that are aging well and they're retaining their cognitive function is that we can describe their diet. Their diet is high in fruits and vegetables. They're not eating a lot of animal fat, so even if they're eating things like beef, they're taking lean cuts. And we know that that diet pattern is very healthy. And so it's true that you'll read in the newspaper that blueberries are healthy, and yes, blueberries are healthy, but so are raspberries and strawberries and all sorts of other fruits and vegetables. And I would argue the important thing is to make sure that you take advantage of the cornucopia of food that's available in North America and eat as wide a variety as you possibly can, rather than trying to focus on individual foods.
In terms of putting together a nutritious meal, there's several things that I like to do in cooking. As a chef, we love to use salt as a flavor enhancer. But the thing is when you start with good ingredients, you don't need to use as much salt because the flavors will speak for themselves. Another important thing is to include balance. Always having a portion of fruits and vegetables, grains, into your diet and not just rely heavily on the proteins. Proteins are really important, but it should be balanced. And one of the things I like to do is use foods that are, again, high in antioxidants and high in vitamins. So you can look to your leafy greens, your spinach, your mustard greens, your Swiss chard. And these, again, are all things that they're just jam-packed with nutritional value.
It's a magnificent place to work. I'm coming from a discipline where there's not a lot of people in nutrition that are working in cognitive health. And I'm in an environment where everybody around me is bringing different forms of expertise as it relates to trying to sustain and maintain brain function as we age. And it's that interdisciplinary, collaborative nature of the environment here that makes it so fruitful in terms of the research. So I can work with cognitive psychologists so that I know my work, while I can describe nutrition interventions, is grounded in cognitive psychology because I work with that expertise on a daily basis. And so I think it's the breadth, the collaborative nature. And then just the expertise of the people that are here. We have some of the best people in the world doing cognitive psychology at Baycrest. And so it is such a privilege now to come in as somebody from a different discipline and be able to play with those people and work with them on a daily basis.
Hello, and thank you all for coming, and thank you to Baycrest for inviting me to facilitate this discussion with Dr. Greenwood, who really is at the Canadian forefront of figuring out not only how we can fuel our brain, but grow it.
Exactly.
And I think one of the things I'd like to start with discussion with you is this idea of what happens to our brain as we get older, just to lay the groundwork for what we're dealing with.
Yes, if we talk in general, and what we do know is that our brains tend to shrink, and that's usually accompanied by loss of some of our brain cells, so that we would see death of those brain cells, and that would be accompanied by the shrinkage. But I think the important thing is that we're finding out just the fact that it doesn't happen to everyone. So some people keep full brain function, they keep full brain size, and other people don't. So it's really trying to discover what it is around that's the important piece of it.
And I do want to spend this time getting a chance to talk to you about what we can do to maintain and sustain our brain development. But I think it's interesting that so many people are so focused on the ways that we can grow our muscles and take care of our heart and take care of our skin. And yet there seems to be relatively little that we look at in how to maintain what is arguably the most important part of our body, which is our brain.
Yes. Well, and I think a lot of it's, you know, it's new, the fact that that we can actually encourage our brain to grow throughout our lifespan, and that we do not have to accept the fact that our cognitive function declines with aging, and that there are things that we can do very proactively in terms of trying to help maintain that function as we age.
So now that you've told us that our brains shrink, which, because we all are aging by the minute, that's terrifying. So let's get into a little bit right off the bat of what we can do can we stop our brains from shrinking?
The evidence would suggest that. I mean, for certain we know that we can help people maintain higher levels of brain function. And all of the data would suggest at this point that it actually can be associated with stopping of the shrinkage at the same time.
So let's bring nutrition into this, because clearly we know the things that we eat affect our ability to build muscles, our ability to feel energized. Talk to me a little bit, or give me some specifics about what nutrition can do to give us a healthy brain.
It's funny, because we all understand how important nutrition is for young infants and brain development. And I think we all grew up with the thoughts that once we grew beyond our adolescence, that there was nothing else we could do for the brain. And I think now we understand just how wrong that is, and that feeding the brain appropriately in terms of good intakes of fruits and vegetables, high intake of fish, eating a very healthy diet, are things that will help contribute and help us maintain our brain function.
And that's interesting, because most people know about heart health or health to prevent certain cancers, or the things that we should do in order to maintain that part of our body, and yet don't think of those things as having a positive impact on our brain, and yet they do.
They do, and I think the other thing that people don't realize is that a lot of those disorders, like the high cholesterol, the high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, where I'm particularly interested, that we all know that that those diseases are obviously bad for us in terms of surviving as we age. But I think very few people realize that those factors are risk factors for cognitive decline in dementia. So we see faster rates of cognitive decline in people with high cholesterol, with high blood pressure, with diabetes. So it's really saying that as we adopt healthy lifestyles, particularly in our 50s and 60s, to make sure that we don't develop those disorders as we age, that we're actually doing something very proactive in terms of trying to maintain our brain health as well.
And that's an interesting aspect then. You're talking about the fact that people who may be looking for other areas they're focused on, their heart, their overall physical health, can actually be benefiting their brain and reducing the risk of dementia as they get older because of the foods that they're eating. They're staying away from what specifically? I mean, if you had a big garbage bin that you could toss all the stuff in that you didn't want people to eat, I'm assuming meat might be up there. I mean, high-fat meats?
Well, the high-fat meats. I mean, certainly from a fat perspective, what we call the saturated fats, or the fats that tend to be with meat, are generally considered bad. The other things that are really coming in and is not being good or is too high of an intake of salt. So high levels of very processed food, so that as you're eating your carbohydrates, you want the more complex, the whole grains, whole grain breads, cereals that are whole grain. So it's the same message, you know, and I think that's the simple part, is that the same message in terms of helping your heart, in terms of what we should be doing from a diet and from an exercise perspective. It's exactly the same message in terms of what we need for our brains.
And yet, and it's my sense, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong, I'm sure, but it's my sense that the medical community is fairly late in coming on board in this, as well as the general public, that there is an ability to actually stop your brain from shrinking and to continue to maintain a cognitive development beyond a certain age. I recall experts talking about how at the time you were 6 or 7, everything had kind of been formed and all you were going to start doing was losing brain cells, and that has shifted.
Oh, it shifted tremendously, and it certainly shifted tremendously over my career in terms of those types of thoughts. And I think that, you know, there's a couple of things that have really come on board in the last little while in order to be able to help us understand that. So what's been within my generation that we've actually learned that we can give birth to new brain cells. So when I was young, you know, sort of, yes, you had all of the brain cells that you were going to have by the time you were, you know, sort of in your adolescence, and it was only downhill after that. and we now know that that's not true. And I think as we started to understand that we could give birth to new cells, we also then started to try to figure out how we could encourage that process. And I think we also have gotten greater understanding in just how adaptive and flexible the brain is. So that if you have an area of the brain that's not functioning as well, we can sort of, you know, sort of side circuit around that so that people can maintain their function. So it's not only, I think one has to look at it globally and sort of holistically. And my interest, of course, is looking at nutrition, but we know that exercise is hugely important. We know that staying socially engaged is very important. We're looking at various types of programs in terms of people participating in cognitive exercises or, you know, playing various types of things that will keep them engaged mentally, and that all of that continues to benefit the brain and help us sustain function as we age.
Can you expand a little bit more on this, the issue that is your strength and your focus, which is nutrition? Is there a way of targeting certain nutrients specifically to our brain so that we know that the brain is gonna develop more?
Yes. Well, I actually prefer to target foods rather than nutrients. And I think if you look across the studies that we've done here at Baycrest or studies that have been done internationally, that we're all kind of merging across the same observations in that people that are retaining their brain function as they age are more likely to be eating fish and particularly fatty fish, so they're getting all of those healthy fish oils through their diet. They're also eating higher levels of fruits and vegetables, and we think that it's the antioxidants that are in the fruits and vegetables that are probably beneficial. And they're also more likely to be eating whole grains. So rather than going from the white breads, going for the whole grain breads, the whole grain cereals. And that probably is also helping in terms of their, you know, sort of the health of their heart, the health of their blood vessels, so that we can get good blood delivery to the brain in order to be able to provide energy and oxygen and all those types of things that that we have. I don't think we have the evidence in terms of saying, is one fruit or one vegetable better than another? So it's really kind of looking at the overall pattern of how somebody eats. And what we need to do in North America, as you're saying, is to minimize our intake of meat, replace it more with fish, and really take advantage of, you know, sort of the vast array of fruit and vegetables that we have available to us.
And the issue of, and you alluded to it but didn't expand on it, so we'll get you to do that now, is just that issue of, we do live in a society that is more prone to taking a quicker way of getting the most nutrients as possible, which does come in the form of supplements and protein shakes and then, you know, all the rest of the stuff that we could do to avoid having to actually sit down and plan a proper meal. Is that as effective to start taking supplements and vitamins?
I think our evidence is saying no, that you're actually better to put that squash in the oven and eat it than to take an antioxidant tablet. And from my perspective, that's not surprising, because a lot of the supplement data is that people would be, let's say, choosing one nutrient. So let's say folate has been something that has been studied a lot, as has vitamin B12. And I always argue that if somebody's diet is low in folate, that folate is very high in fruits and vegetables, so it's probably telling me that their diet is low in fruits and vegetables, and that's why they're low in folate. And folate's not the only healthy thing in a fruit and vegetable. So you've really got to go back to the full food and get all of the other nutrients that are available in that fruit and vegetable. And I think it's also, you know, we've heard lots in terms of non-vitamins that are healthy components of foods. So whether it's the lycopenes in tomatoes or, you know, some of the catechins that are in green tea, or, I mean, we know a lot in terms of plant foods that they contain other very healthy ingredients. And you're not going to get those in a supplement. You get those by eating food. So I think it makes sense that the evidence is telling us that the supplement is not the way to go, that we really have to go back to the food.
Because the challenge is that we're being bombarded by every marketing scam in the universe. Everyone wants to jump on blueberries are hot next this week, and it's pomegranate the week before, and any kind of other antioxidants. So when you walk through, I mean, even in grocery stores, the vast array of nutritional supplements that are available, it does seem sometimes easier to just yank one of those off the shelf and think, well, I'll get all of the antioxidants I need there, all the folate that I need, instead of actually thinking about how to put together a meal that might give you the same thing.
It is true, and I think there's a number of different things that are contributing to that. One is that when we do research, we research one food at a time, simply because we can't, you know, do research across a whole number of different foods. So if I was wanting to look at fruits or berries, and I did my research in blueberries, I could really only tell you, you know, when you're asking me about my studies, what the outcome was on the blueberry, because that's what I studied. And I think what we do is we fail to put that back into a broader context in terms of what that means in terms of fruit and vegetable intake, rather than focusing just on the blueberry. So at the food level, it's right, we have people banging around, it's blueberries this week, pomegranates next week, and who knows what it's going to be the week after, rather than standing back and looking at the more the epidemiology that's out there, or understanding eating patterns from populations, and the fact that the results from the blueberries are consistent with what we see in terms of studying people that have high intakes of fruits and vegetables. So not allowing people to move back into that context, I think, is really important. And I think the other important part of it is that if I stand up here and say eating blueberries is good for your brain, and you're telling me, but I don't like blueberries, I haven't given you a message that you can take home and really use. It's probably better for me to be standing here and saying, you know, fruits and vegetables are good, and, you know, go out and really excite your palate. So there's that part of the messaging, I think, that we haven't done a good job of. The other is, somehow or another, we've convinced people that they don't have time to cook anymore. And we've done very good marketing on that. And you know,
or that somehow it's better. I mean, we've gone through generations, we've gone through that, you know, science in a pharmaceutical way can do it better than what can naturally be done. That somehow, you know, formula would be better than breastfeeding in one generation, and taking a pill would be better than actually getting it from the earth where it grew.
That's right. And I think what we're seeing is, you know, sort of naturally evolving back into more of a, you know, kind of a whole food, local food, kind of a phenomena, because you're not going to convince me that there's a lot of work to pick up a pear and eat it. So why is it easier for somebody to pick up a pill than to pick up a pear?
It doesn't taste as good either.
No, that's right. That's right. So I think, you know, we've bought in to the argument that we don't have time to prepare food. Yet there's lots of foods that you can buy that are partially prepared, that are healthy, that you can bring home and put on your plate.
I don't know if I'm going to like the answer to the question, but I'll ask it anyway. So if we're talking about the ability to stave off things like dementia, things like forgetfulness and various stages of dementia as we age, is there a point that we know there's not much more that you can do? Is there an age where all the nutrients that you put into your body, you're not going to be able to stave that off?
Probably from a nutrition perspective, I'd have to say that we haven't studied it well enough. We do know, and certainly from studies that are ongoing here and elsewhere, that at just about any stage of the lifespan, if people engage in some of these cognitive programs in terms of cognitive exercises, if they engage in physical activity, that at the end of those programs, people have, not only have they not lost cognitive function, they've actually gained cognitive function. So by the end of participating in those programs, they're functioning better than they had before they started. So can we achieve cognitive gain in individuals, even though they may be in their, you know, 70s and 80s? And the answer to that is absolutely yes. The degree to which the sort of the nutrition change is going to be able to show the same kind of gain is what we're actually trying to understand right now. But I think that the story really is optimistic, and people don't realize that they really have control to a certain extent over how their brain ages. And there are very powerful things that they can do to improve brain function.
And I think there's been a fair amount of discussion in the public about mental gymnastics that you can do to kind of keep your brain agile. But I do think, and I've covered health issues for a lot of years, and I don't recall there being a whole lot of discussion about the way you can feed your brain through nutrients. So it's the research that you're doing is hugely beneficial.
Oh, well, thank you. And yes, I mean, I think it's, you know, as we get more and more understanding just in terms of how we use the term plastic, you know, meaning that we can continue to change the brain as we as we age, as we understand those processes, we're learning better and better how to feed it. So feeding it from my perspective is nutrition, feeding it from an exercise physiologist's perspective is the best types of physical activities that people should be engaged in. And we are, you know, sort of getting more and more a better understanding of what it is that we need to do.
So if I can get some more specifics from you, because I know we've talked about good fats.
Yeah.
In terms, I always think of it as kind of lubricating the brain. Like it just, you know, there has been such a focus on banning all kinds of fats from our diet when we went through the no-fat phase that I could kind of almost see the body and the brain is just almost shriveling up because it's just not getting the kind of grease that it needs in order to function. Is that at all accurate or just my own?
Well, I know. I mean, it is accurate.
She's going to say no. I can hear it now.
No. Well, I mean, I think there's a couple of things going on. Is that one of the things that we know is that brain is hugely dependent on a good blood supply. Because we've got to get the nutrition there, we have to get, you know, the oxygen for our brain to function. So anything that we're doing to help maintain our blood vessels is continuing to feed the brain. So that some of the things in terms of fat is not only making sure that we have the right fats for the brain to function, but it's also that we have the right fats in terms of keeping our blood vessels healthy.
So give me some examples of what the right fats are then.
Well, and I think when we talk about the right fats, I mean, we all know that fish oils, you know, fall in there or the general category of omega-3s. But it's also, you know, things that we call in the biz, you know, sort of the monounsaturated fats or the MUFAs. And those are the fats that are predominantly in the olive oils. And, you know, then we kind of get into sort of the, you know, kind of the Canadian shyness to a certain extent in that there's no question that olive oil is a good fat to be eating for both our brains and our blood vessels. But our own canola oil has almost as good of a fat profile as olive oil.
That's interesting. So I don't think, because we're so focused on the Mediterranean diet as being something that's something to follow.
That's right.
And you're saying that the Canadian diet, well, in as far as canola oil,
yes,
it could be as effective.
That's right. No, I'm not going to say that canola oil and olive oil taste the same, but in terms of a healthy source of fat, I mean, it's one of our own prime agricultural products, and using it as a predominant fat in your diet, and you know, reserving the olive oils for when you're really looking for that rich flavor that comes from the olive oil is actually a perfectly healthy way to be doing it.
When we think about our body as having a certain biorhythm, where we feel good at certain parts of the day and sort of down or low at others energy-wise, obviously that has a huge impact on the brain and what you're doing to feed it or starve it.
Yes, and that's true. And the and I think it's very interesting because what we see is that those patterns change. And I jokingly say that if you're trying to plan a family event, that lunch is always the best time to do it because the adolescents have finally gotten out of bed and the older people haven't crawled in yet.
So that and it's not as much work to put together lunch than dinner.
Everybody's still awake, that's right. But I think what we do know is that when we hit those natural lows, that we can temporarily boost our function, improve our alertness and our memory function by eating carbohydrate foods. And what we're really doing at that point is we're providing the brain with glucose, which is what carbohydrate is, and just kind of giving it that extra boost of energy in order to be able to function.
Because when there was the anti-fat craze, it was replaced by the anti-carb phase. So, I mean, to hear someone say, go out and eat carbohydrates, there are a lot of people who are still in that mode of feeling like those are evil.
That's right.
That they spike your insulin and that it's just not a productive way of feeding yourself.
Well, and I mean, the moderation word does have to come in.
Yeah, well,
every,
no
while.
One's good at moderation.
Right. We don't like
that's
that moderation
problem.
Word. That's right. Although, you know, in the studies that we would do, we would be giving people a reasonable amount of carbohydrates. So we do it on a weight basis, but it would be the equivalent of, let's say, eating two pieces of bread or, you know, quite probably about two cups of pasta. So reasonably large servings. And even with that, we find that we're not overloading people in terms of their function and that they that they do perform better after they've had those foods. The one exception that we have is people with diabetes. And I think in there, that's what is happening, is because people with diabetes have more difficulty handling the glucose that they're consuming, that their blood levels go way too high. But we can prevent that by having people eat those more, even the individuals with diabetes, eat the more complex carbohydrates that trickle into the body more slowly. And in those situations, even the person with diabetes can actually show temporary improvement in function.
Can you talk a little bit more about you've done some exciting research on type 2 diabetes when it comes to nutrition and brain development?
Yeah, it's been a long journey, and started many years ago where we were actually providing the evidence that consuming high saturated fat diets seem to be associated with a loss of cognitive function, and we're trying to understand why. And we thought then, and we've eventually figured out that the connection is that the types of diets that we were feeding were actually the types of diets that were promoting diabetes. So these were all done in rats. And then I kind of, in my own journey, felt that I wanted to leave my professional life doing more than just figuring out how to make a rat dumb. That was kind of, then it went over to try to apply it into a human context and working with people with diabetes. And I think we've got greater understanding now in terms of what it is about diabetes that seems to be so adversive to the brain. And as we're understanding that, then we're understanding what it is about treatment of diabetes that people really need to be focusing on as they're focusing in terms of wanting to make sure that they're also maintaining their brain health as well.
So someone who does have type 2 diabetes and hears you say that might be justifiably alarmed that with that already difficult disease to handle, also comes the prospect of potential difficulties with cognitive
With cognitive health. It's true, and it is alarming, and that there's no question that diabetes is considered a risk factor for cognitive health. But the good news is that you don't have to go that journey. That we know that people that are maintaining good levels of diabetes control are functioning the same as somebody without diabetes.
And is that through nutrition?
It would be a combination of nutrition and then medical management. So some people would be taking medications at the same time, and that I would say would really be very much governed by your physician in terms of how to best control your diabetes. But it is saying that if you're developing those types of risk factors, that whilst, silent diseases are always difficult, right, in terms of people staying the hard and narrow and keeping on treatment. But I think what it's saying is that if you do sort of attend to what you need to do in order to be able to control your diabetes, that really you're optimistically looking forward to years of brain health. With the negative aspect is that if you don't attend to it, not only are you looking at possibilities in terms of amputation and heart attack, but that it also may be putting you at risk for dementia. And people have the option to choose which journey they want to make, but there's no reason that we have to accept that diabetes is going to lead to cognitive decline and dementia. It's only a poorly controlled diabetes that does that.
I think that's an interesting point you make, that people have the choice to choose which kind of journey they want to make from a health perspective in their life, because I think most of us are aware of that when it comes to taking care of our external body as well as sort of the muscles in our body, but still don't have that sense that we have control over what will happen to our brain as we age.
It's true. Now, as we say that, I mean, there will be some people that will have sort of genetic predisposition to disorders, and we haven't really learned how to help combat that. But in general, for the average person, they have tremendous control. And I think the younger you take that control in terms of making sure that you're, sort of meeting your health needs, the better your journey is going to be in terms of brain health. So for instance, we're starting to find in some of the data that having a lot of the disorders that we're talking about, the hypertension, the high cholesterol, the diabetes in our 50s, is more predictive of your brain health in your 70s than people that are developing it in their in their later 60s. So the longer the brain is exposed to the adverse environment, the more likely it is that you're going to see cognitive decline. So we've really got to start messaging to people in their 40s and 50s that that one is that they have tremendous power to impact how their brain is going to age, and that now is the time that they really start, they need to be attending to it.
It's almost as though an entire chunk of our demographic has been left out of the loop on this, because there's a very clear understanding of the importance of having children be fed properly before they go to school and try to learn anything. I mean, we're well aware of the importance of a healthy young mind.
Yeah.
And then we're also aware of the things that we need to do as we're older. But in this area where you're saying there's the optimal ability for actually making a difference and staving off dementia, we've just kind of missed the boat.
We have, and it's kind of why, right? It's if we know that a young brain needs nutrition and that an older brain needs nutrition, why do we think that need goes away just because we're mid-aged? And I think that's the part that hasn't really had full understanding, is that need in terms of breakfast, the need in terms of keeping, sort of healthy diets, feeding the brain, that's really a lifelong process, and not something that's just targeted at either end of the lifespan.
One of the things that may be difficult, though, that as you age, your appetite decreases. So when if you were to sit here and give us a cooking rundown of what we should make in order to have optimal health for our brain, it may be a bit overwhelming to think about having a big breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Is that an area where you would see supplements as possibly being effective?
Oh, absolutely. And I think there are a couple. I mean, as much as, I do believe that we can eat healthily from the food supply, that I think there are quite appropriate times that we would be using supplements. But there I would say that the multivitamin, multi-mineral preparation is better. I mean, rather than targeting at one, just go for the whole gamut. There's no data. I mean, I have, my parents are now in their late 80s and early 90s, and they certainly are not eating the volumes of food that they used to eat in their youth. So I very much encourage them to take a vitamin mineral preparation. And we all also know that we hit life events where it's stressful, we're not attending to our health during that period as we're moving through the stress of those life events. So being looking at what you can do to support yourself through that with the best health is also appropriate.
And I guess there's also a fairly big jump that if you were talking about your mom and dad being in their 80s and 90s, what they believed to be nutritious is vastly different from what it is now. Is that a hurdle that you have to overcome in order to reach certain age groups?
The I think for many people that are in their 80s, while it's true, I mean, we would have started off with sort of the traditional, what we call the traditional North American diet, that was sort of this much meat and that much veg on the plate, and we're trying to get them to reverse it. That by the time most people are in their 80s, they've probably already are being told that by their family physician anyway, and they're more being told that around heart health. So I think the messaging, the messaging is there, but how to do it is still difficult. And I think that there are many things that we can be doing that are easy to help us increase our intakes of fruits and vegetables. That
give us some.
Well, for instance, I mean, everybody loves soup. Making soups that have lots of vegetables in it, or even if you're starting with a canned soup, there's nothing to stop you from chopping up some vegetables and putting some extra fresh vegetables in that soup before you sit down. Making sure that you're moving on to fruit juices, so I think there's very easy things. Getting more beans and pulses into your diet is sort of using canned ones where you're sprinkling, let's say, lentils or chickpeas or whatever on your salads. It's very simple things that you can do that don't require you to actually have to change your cooking or be spending hours and hours in front of a stove.
Okay, that's interesting, because I'm surprised to hear you say canned soup, and I'm surprised to hear you say even canned vegetables. My sense was that the more raw it was, the more nutrient rich it was. But are you saying that as a start, that's a way to go, but ultimately the goal is to do
absolutely, as much raw? Absolutely. So start with something that you're familiar with, and then add a couple of things to make it healthier. And then I think as you start to get in the habit of chopping your vegetables in order to be able to add into your canned soup, you'll eventually get to the point where you realize, gosh, I'm chopping, I don't need the can anymore. But it's kind of little steps in order to be able to get you to the end goal.
I just have a couple more questions for you, but I want to let you know that we're going to take questions from you in the next couple of minutes. So if there are any questions that you have, specifics to deal with how to grow your brain, keep your brain healthy, there'll be microphones going around and you can ask some questions. I'm interested to know, Dr. Greenwood, where you think the research is going in this, because as we were talking, this is a burgeoning field, the recognition that we do have control over how our brain ages. Is it something that's widely accepted beyond Baycrest and you into the greater medical community and into the, as well as the public?
I think it is getting accepted into the greater medical community, and I've just come back from an annual meeting of neuroscientists, so you can imagine.
Sounds impressive. I've never been invited to one of those.
40,000 nerdy neuroscientists all in the same city at once. It's a bizarre situation in and of itself, and I think what we're seeing is more and more, even within the very hardcore neuroscientist community, that it's getting more and more accepted as mainstream. There was more nutrition talks there. I think many physicians now are very much understanding the link between, sort of the diabetes, the cholesterol, and the blood pressure as it relates to brain health. So I think that the medical community is now, sort of getting more accepting of the idea. And so that's where it's time to start making sure that we have very solid science and that it really is time to move it out to the public.
Because I think that's really a groundbreaking, just in my discussions with you before we came out here, and also from listening to what you've had to say now, I don't think many people are aware of the fact that all of the things that they do that are good for their body, their heart, and every other part of their body, is actually having a huge impact in the way that they age from a brain perspective.
Absolutely. And probably the comforting issue is that we're not finding very much that's unique to the brain. So that what you're needing to do in terms of cholesterol, what you're needing to do in hypertension, all of the kinds of health advice, be it physical activity or diet, that it's all common across all of them. I think the other part, though, that we're starting to really get a much better understanding of is the importance of things like staying socially engaged, like keeping your brain stimulated. And so as we're going back to sort of that, it becomes more and more of a holistic, sort of messaging in terms of keeping yourself active, keeping engaged, including eating healthily and exercising within all of that, and that all of that is going to work cooperatively with one another in terms of helping us maintain health.
Okay. Other questions? I'm not sure. Do we have a microphone? Mm. I think right up here.
We hear so much about antioxidants. Is there such a thing as getting too many?
The question is whether or not we can get too much antioxidant in our diet. I think we're at the point where we understand that with all nutrients, that we can get too much. So that when you start to look at sort of the new nutrition recommendations that are going on, not only are we providing estimates of how much people should consume, but also what would be considered a toxic level. So something like the antioxidants, we have quite a wide range, and so it would be very difficult, particularly from food, to eat too much. But people can run into problems if they're taking supplements, in particular single supplements, that they can't actually give themselves too much, yes. And the different antioxidants will have different side effects associated with them.
And we have a question back here.
Type 2 diabetes and fruit drinks as opposed to eating raw fruit. What's the difference?
The difference really is in the how quickly we absorb the sugars from the fruit drinks. So the advantage of whether we're talking whole grains or whole fruits and whole vegetables is that the process, it takes us longer to digest those foods, and so consequently we absorb the sugars that are in just about all foods more slowly. So if you have difficulty handling sugar, which is, you know, a hallmark of type 2 diabetes, the more slowly it trickles into the system, the better it is.
And we've got a question back here.
Hi there. Regarding your foods versus supplementation,
yep.
Don't you have to eat quite a bit to get the right amount of vitamins? Like you have to eat all day if you don't take supplements?
That's actually not true. And you know, most of the data that we would study, where I was saying we're looking at information from large populations, is that we find that in average, people that are, you know, sort of coming close to meeting Canada's nutrition recommendations in terms of, you know, 5 to 7 servings of fruits and vegetables a day, that they're really doing reasonably well. The problem is that as Canadians, we're probably not eating that much. So it's saying, you know, if you're sitting down to a bowl of cereal, put some fruit on top of it. So I think there are easy and practical ways where we can look at trying to eat more fruit and vegetables.
And there's a question there, and then there's a woman up here with a purple jacket on too, in the third row. We can take the one at the back first, maybe, while you get your microphone.
My question is concerning most of our foods now are highly contaminated with pesticides. What's your thought on eating more organic fruits and vegetables, even meats, to help nourish our bodies and brains?
It's an excellent question. I think what we don't have from the brain health perspective is hard data as it relates to the pesticides that are in our food supply. But I think, you know, just sort of in general, we feel that that they're not good. So moving more into the organic part of the grocery store is certainly beneficial. I tend to be someone who really likes to promote eating local. And part of it is, I just think that the flavor and the freshness of the fruits and vegetables that we're buying from our local farmers markets, they just taste so much better. And so consequently, you're going to want to eat more because they're much more flavorful. So I think the more we move on to local foods, the more we continue to encourage farmers to find alternate ways in terms of minimizing pesticide use, that all of those better is really just going to move forward in terms of improving the food supply.
And the woman, the patient woman in the purple.
Dr. Greenwood, would you be kind enough, I don't know whether this refers to the same question you just answered, but my concern is with eating farmed fish as opposed to eating wild fish.
Yep.
And also, would you be kind enough to please tell me what are alternative sources of vitamin E? Would it be walnuts?
The walnuts would be a good alternative source of vitamin E. I think personally that there's no question that our farm fish are carrying slightly higher levels of toxicants than our wild fish. But I do think it was one of those things that got overblown when that was coming out. So that if you look at what Health Canada feels is a reasonably safe level of exposure, and let's just say it's the unit is 100, because I don't remember the exact numbers, that really what it was saying is that wild fish had 2 of those units and farm fish had 4 of those units. So the farm fish was definitely higher, but we were still so far away from what would be safe exposure that it really didn't need to be the fear-mongering message that I think a lot of us got. That said, we realize that as we continue to pollute our waters, that we are getting more and more problems associated with contaminants getting into fish. And particularly Canada and most of the developing countries have brought in very strict regulations so that fish over certain sizes are not allowed to be sold and used for human consumption. And it's on the argument that the bigger a tuna is, the older it is, and the more likely it will have consumed various types of contaminants over its lifespan. So I think as all of this is happening, that that we see that our health organizations, whether it's the Food and Drug Administration in the U.S. or Health Canada at this point, are responding in a way of trying to be able to keep the public healthy. I think there's 2 other pieces of that, though, that one is, of course, we're seeing increased interest in terms of people angling or fishing in terms of sport, and that we're not looking in terms of the contamination of our groundwaters and in our lakes, but that most provincial organizations put out lots of information in terms of individual lakes and what people can safely consume from the lakes where they're catching. But it also comes from the fact that as our habits are poisoning and adding toxins to our lake waters, that really what we're saying is our groundwaters are becoming polluted, and that ultimately those groundwaters are feeding our fruits and vegetables. So we have to deal with pollution in general, because we talk about it in terms of fish, but it's a problem, and we really have to learn how to change how we treat the earth if we're going to be able to maintain a healthy food supply.
And it's one of the curses of becoming more aware, because the more aware you become of one issue, you realize that when you're standing at the grocery store trying to find the food that's actually going to be healthy for you, at every turn there's, you know, farm fish, organic meat, you're kind of swamped with pros and cons, and
yes,
also
there are.
And also huge differences in price tags.
Yes, and so not everyone has the discretionary income where they can afford the organic products.
And what you're saying then is that the organic does not necessarily guarantee any healthier product than the non-organic?
It is saying that the organic is not going to have the pesticides, or they're not going to have been used in the producing. But if we're talking about groundwater, you know, our earth and our water becoming contaminated, then no. Anything that a plant is getting out of the groundwater, it doesn't make any difference whether or not the farmer has organic or not organic farming practices. So we really do have to look, you know, very globally in terms of what we're doing to the quality of our soil and the quality of our water in general.
Okay. I think there's a question at the back.
Okay, I've been hearing about dark chocolate, and I'm a chocolate-holic.
So can I give you permission to eat it?
Yeah.
I will. The dark chocolate happens to be very high in antioxidants. So it is, I will have to say that it is yet another food that has very high levels of antioxidants. So whether we're talking about sitting down to some squash or sitting down to a cup of tea or sitting down to a bite of dark chocolate, that you're doing all of that in order to be able to get your antioxidants. I would prefer to make sure that you have all three of those sometime during the day rather than a diet of only chocolate. But yes, small amounts of dark chocolate are definitely providing you with high levels of antioxidants.
Okay, since she brought up dark chocolate, I'll bring up wine and
red
wine.
Okay. We all
since
have
we
our
know,
poisons,
since
that's
we know
right.
A glass of red wine is good for our heart, does that mean it's also good for our brain?
Yes, the evidence is saying that it is. We do have some good news here tonight. One is that you can do something about your brain health, and it's going to be some fun foods as well. And I remember years ago when I was on the a Health Canada committee where we were establishing the recommendations around alcohol and starting to realize that red wine in moderation was healthy for the heart, that we came out with recommendations that were based on a glass of wine. And I thought that was delightful because I had these great big bowl glass wines.
Not a bowl of wine,
right.
A glass.
But not a bowl. Well, no, I mean, you know, the great big goblets,
goblet.
Right? But I think, yes, I mean, sort of moderate use. And so moderate, we're generally talking about enjoying a glass of wine with dinner, but not the bottle.
Mm. I wasn't implying that I was after the bottle. The glass is all I need. Thank you. And a question here?
Would you say is the safest for us to eat?
The safest. Well, if you're looking in terms of trying to get the good sources of fish in terms of the right fish oils, is we're really talking about things like salmon, mackerel, sardines. Generally, you know, sort of fatty fish that's coming from the ocean, because those tend to be, whitefish is not a very fat fish in general, so you're better to go on to the darker flesh fish in order to be able to be getting all of those fish oils. That said, things like, some of the black cods that would come out of our northern waters, not the regular cod, but the black cod, can also get fairly high levels of fish oils as well. And I think the other thing that people forget in all of this is that when we're talking fish, that canned salmon has fish oil in it the same way that a salmon fillet does.
Tuna as well?
Tuna, not as much. But, you know, when it comes back to, you know, the discretionary ability to afford some of the foods, that it doesn't have to only be the fresh salmon that you're buying from the fishmonger, that you can be doing things like making salmon sandwiches for lunch and getting a serving of fish that way.
On the opposite end of the chocolate and wine, what sardines? Are they good?
Sardines are good,
they are
yes,
good.
Yeah. And the I grew up with sardines as a child, so I still enjoy them, but it probably is an acquired taste, but building, you know, sort of more broad fish into the diet, it would be worthwhile, yeah.
Okay, we have time for two more questions. We'll take one at the back.
You talked a little bit about the link between nutrition, the brain, and dementia. I'm wondering if there's any other links for mental illness and what foods should be eaten to prevent various types of other mental illnesses or coping with mental illness.
Well, I think we know that that depression itself will have a large link, and that certainly diets that are low in fruits and vegetables because they're low in vitamins can actually be associated with depressive illnesses. So looking in terms of you know, that we're talking about it in terms of cognitive health, it's certainly just sort of broadly from a mood disorder perspective that it is probably beneficial as well. When you start to get into some of the other mental disorders, the part of the problem is that some of the effective medications can actually increase the risk of developing disorders like type 2 diabetes. So I think trying to look at managing the health of the individual in the context of the medication is a key part of it. But that will probably generally have to be done sort of with the physician to make sure that you don't have any interactive things going on.
I remember doing a story on ADHD in children, and one of the interesting things that came out of it, and maybe you can speak to it, is that a diet rich in omega-3s and as well as fish oil, so the omega-3, 6s and 9s, I believe, were incredibly effective in helping kids just bring that level of hyperactivity down. And again, I say lubricate the brain, but give the brain the kind of oils that may have been lacking in children with ADHD.
Yeah, and I think, you know, there's a lot of research right now going on as it relates to the fish oils as it relates to depression, and not only looking in terms of low intake of fish as predisposing people to develop depressions, but also trying to minimize the use of medication by bringing in sort of healthier diets with a focus on the fish oils and the omega-3s as one of the nutrients that people are looking at, and it looks very promising in terms of the data that's coming out.
Okay, so we have one question over here.
I'd like to know whether you've done any research on celiac disease, and because of the malabsorption of vitamins and minerals, because of the gluten, how does that affect your brain?
Function? I think it's a great question that I can't give you the answer to, but you're quite right. As we get into any of the disorders of our gut. And the fact that can impact our nutritional health, it would be very important to get more insight into, and we don't have it at this point.
And I'm getting the wrap up for the last question, but I know Dr. Greenwood will be here afterwards to speak to you all, so we'll take the last question here.
Okay, I'm glad that lady mentioned celiac disease, because I'm a diabetic, type 2, and a celiac. And if you think that isn't fun finding decent food to eat, it is. It's a challenge. My biggest concern is genetically modified foods. I love avocados. Do they taste like avocados? Not always. A pear, a peach, all this sort of stuff that we get from the South. God, it tastes like nothing on earth. You know, I remember when a peach used to taste like a peach. What do you do with that?
Yeah, I think, you know, that people are concerned in terms of the genetically modified foods. And I think at this point in time, we don't have enough knowledge in terms of the health effects. I absolutely agree that in order for us to have, you know, sort of fresh fruits and vegetables in our grocery stores, that they get picked long before they're ripened. And they just do not have the flavor of a fresh picked fruit and vegetable. And that is why I'm such an advocate of eating our local food supply. So, you know, it's
take advantage of, you know, sort of the Ontario produce. We have wonderful peaches that come when we have Ontario peaches in our grocery stores. It is true that it's a shorter season. So whether you're looking at, you know, sort of trying to freeze some or relying more on the citrus fruits that are available in the winter, that's the problem with Canada, is we don't have local foods throughout the year. The other thing I'd like to say just before
I was supposed to do that. I'm sorry. Let me do it just so I can wrap up doing a proper job. Mm. Do you have a need for volunteers?
We have a huge need for volunteers. That's right. The you know, clearly in sort of a campus as large as Baycrest, we just have many different types of studies that are going on that relate to cognitive health, and we need people that are both healthy and can show us just how great it is when they do sustain cognitive function, as well as people that are experiencing difficulties. And, you know, we're just desperate to have people come and participate in our studies. Also, various types of programs that maybe, as we're trying to understand the types of programs that will be effective, that we need volunteers for that. And I believe that we do have someone here today that can take names and phone numbers so that we can contact you at future times.
It was an absolute pleasure meeting you, and
thank you.
Thank you for
pleasure
informing
as well.
Us. Thank you, and thank you all for coming.
Thank you.